Right away, we'll go into financial accounting reporting. So very, very important kind of 1.5 hour of today, because this is something really new for us. We have read about the accounting standards of India. In case if you have any of the SCA intermediate or dropouts chartered accountants or the qualified chartered accountants, but we have not read about the core US GAAP and the legislation and various things, because we have been following the Indian literature and now we are back to the US literature, right? So this is where we started off with. So just to give you a background about US GAAP and how it kind of came into. So we had a 1929 crash, right, of stock market, where there were a record 12.9 million shares were being traded, right? So that was a Black Monday, they used to tell, and Dow Jones, which is one of the traded index. And that was something where we saw the Dow Jones plunging by 13%. And then next day, again, the Dow Jones plunged by 12%, which is known as Black Tuesday. So Dow is kind of an index which tracks the entire shares of the US listed companies. And that was a 1929 crash. And the crash happened because of various reasons, because of the oil crisis, because of the margin trading, raising the interest rates by the Federal Reserve. So these were some of the things which happened. And then there was an agricultural crisis, public panic happened, and also there were a lot of things which happened and led to the great downfall of stock market in 1929. Then two common sense rules came into the picture after that entire crash which have happened, because you can see that after that, there was a Great Depression also. Very, very interesting stories. Such a fantastic subject to kind of read about and how the standards have come into. Because the book only says that the standard have this. But how they have come into picture was because of these various things which have happened in the past. So the 1929 stock market crash. And then we had two common sense rules which were coming up, that to tell to brokers, dealers and exchanges that they must treat the investors fairly. That was the first common sense rule which came into after the 1929 stock market crash. And the second was that the truth about the businesses when they are offering into IPO, because a lot of the businesses, they were trying to speculate. A lot of the shares were going up and down. And through that, there are a lot of illegal activities which were happening up. So then the investor protection, the various things came into thing, the regulations and all sort of thing. And then we got into the SEC. If you see there, Securities Exchange Commission. So if you see the first paragraph, 1.1 standard setting bodies in the US. So in the US, the SEC has the legal authority to establish US generally accepted accounting principles GAAP. However, in most instances, the SEC has allowed the accounting profession to establish GAAP and self-regulate. The SEC and three different accounting bodies of the accounting profession have determined GAAP since 1934. Now, what have happened was SEC is nothing like how we have in India SEBI, Securities Exchange Board of India, like that only, which regulate our Indian stock market. SEC is the body which is there in US, which regulates the US stock markets, right? So SEC was established by Securities Exchange Act of 1934. All companies that issue securities in the US are subject to SEC rules and regulations. So the SEC has issued public company accounting, specific accounting rules and regulations and regulation SX, financial reporting releases, accounting series releases, so interpretive releases, staff accounting bulletins, EITFs, SEC observer comments. So there are so much literature which came into existence. Then we had something called as the Committee on Accounting Procedure, which was a part-time committee of the AICPA that promulgated accounting research bulletins, which determined GAAP from 1939 until 1959. Then came Accounting Principle Board, was from 1959 to 1973. So the last one which came into was the FASB. So this is something which is very, very important, right? So Financial Accounting Standard Board was the one which kind of came into the picture. So in 1973, an independent full-time organization called the Financial Accounting Standard Board was established, and it has determined gaps since then. Through 2009, the FASB issued Statement of Financial Accounting Standard Board, FASB Interpretation, FASB Technical Bulletins, Emerging Task Force Guidelines. So these were all being taken. So there was a collective decision to drop out the Accounting Principle Board and the Committee on Accounting Procedures. And they said, guys, So let's establish FASB, because the Committee on Accounting Procedure, Accounting Principle Board, changing various things and all, and let's go into a uniform accounting standard board, which was there in 1973, which FASB came into existence. So the FASB has 7 full-time members, very, very important question for MCQ, right? The FASB has 7 full-time members who serve the 5-year terms and may be reappointed to 1 additional 5-year term. The board members must sever connections with firms or institutions before joining the board. Now, anyone who asks you that who is the standard setting body in the US? So what is the answer, guys, for you? Who are the ones who propagate, who adopts the standards in US? It is nothing but Financial Accounting Standard Board, right? So this is the answer which you should always give, even if they ask in interview or anything. FASB is the first one. So after my first class, please go to LinkedIn, please go to Facebook, follow the FASB page. A lot of updates come onto the accounting and all. Keep seeing, I'm very close to the chairman also. The chairman kind of resigned FASB, I think a month back. And now we have the new FASB chairman. So I keep reading the various drafts and all. So you guys can follow FASB on that particular front. And any new standard changes and all, they are always kept into on LinkedIn, Facebook, and the various social media platforms. On Twitter as well, FASB is very active. So these are very, very important things. Now, again, one more important thing where we talk about FASB accounting standard codifications. So the vast number of standards issued by the Committee on Accounting Procedures, the Accounting Principle Board, and the Financial Accounting Standard Board, as well as additional guidance provided by SEC and AICPA, made it difficult for users to access the full body of US GAAP. Effective July 1st, 2009, the FASB Accounting Standard Codification became the single source of authoritative non-governmental US GAAP. Now, this is very, very important. So here they are talking about non-governmental. So when they ask you about governmental, the body will be GASB, which is Governmental Accounting Standard Board. So that's where you will see that the last 3 chapters, which are there, F8, F9, and F10. So they talk more about GASB, which is Governmental Accounting Standard Board. Very, very confusing chapters, last 3 chapters, because they don't follow any principles, any logic. There is absolutely no logic behind what they are doing in their accounting. When we'll go into F8, F9, F10, especially F9 and F10, you will be like, hey, what the hell is happening in these chapters? Because they are not following accrual. Sometimes they follow accrual. Sometimes they follow cash method. Sometimes they follow mixed methods, right? So that is what you will see in the Governmental Accounting Standard Boards, so which is GASB. And they are being typically being issued only for the government-oriented entities. So Chirag, where you're telling FASB is for non-issuer and GASB for issuer is incorrect. So FASB is for issuers only, and GASB is also for issuers only. The only difference is that FASB is for only the non-governmental stuff, which are the listed US companies like Apple, Microsoft, Google, Netflix. So these are the companies, or many of the listed companies in the US. Even for the non-listed companies also, FASB kind of promulgates standard, but you have something called as Private Company Council, which is there to establish alternative to US GAAP. Need not be that they follow the entire literature. So that is what it is, right? I hope everyone is getting this. So anyone, if we ask you, FASB is only for the non-governmental entities, right? GASB is for governmental entities. So that is something which is really important for everyone to understand. Now, what is the difference between issuer and non-issuer? Very good question, Dhairya. So good that I'll take you all to in that particular thing, because that's where we created a capital markets group, which is a stock market group in our Telegram, which is very, very important that you guys be there. So what are the issuers? Is nothing that they list their company in the stock market to raise money from the market, because they want to raise the brand name, or they are shortage of funds, so they go to public. So issued companies are the one who raise their money from the public, right? And I want you guys to go through some of the movies also of the Wall Street, very, very famous movies you have. So after our first class, I hope that you guys have that interest to check Wall Street. So Wall Street is like our Nifty, right, in India. Sensex and Nifty, whereby US Mint is known as Wall Street. We have the Wolf of Wall Street movie also. Very, very interesting, beautiful movie. So we'll see some of this. And so these are the companies which are listed on NASDAQ, right? So they're to raise the money from the public, right? So NASDAQ is nothing but you're listing your shares into the public, where you're inviting kind of the public to kind of purchase those shares and all. And so what is a share actually? So it is simple, guys. So I am earning profits. I don't have money. In order to grow business, you need money, right, Dheeriya? So what you will do is you will go to the public and tell, come on, invest in my company. And what I will do is I will give you a share of my profits, whatever I earn. So typically, how is it different from the loans and all? So what happens in loans, you kind of take money and pay interest, right, to the lenders and all. Here, what you do is you pay profits as in the part of dividends to the shareholders because they have invested in your company. So they would like to kind of have the share of the profits, right? So this is something which you'll need to take into account. I hope that kind of clarifies the area. So issuers is nothing but one who goes to the public and raise the money, and we'll come closer as and when we go into the concepts. I hope you understand till now on the very layman terms. So if you don't have money, you go to the stock market, raise money from the public, tell him that, hey, come on, I'll give you a share of my profits in the form of dividends. So purchase my shares, I'll keep giving you dividends out of my profits. That's all. And that's how he becomes a shareholder. You become a company, you raise the money, you show that in your balance sheet. Okay. Next comes the private company council. And then we have the financial accounting foundation. So NASDAQ Dow Jones is in primary secondary market, or how it is classified since we have. So the financial accounting foundation created the private company council to improve the standard setting for privately held companies in the US. The goal of PCC is to establish alternatives to US GAAP where appropriate to make private company financial statements more relevant, less complex and cost beneficial. So why are so much literature being kept into? I hope everyone is able to see my screen on the literature stuff. So I'm just sharing something which is really important. So if you see this, guys, there are almost of around 995 accounting standard codification. Matlab, this is like huge. I mean, this is really huge. If you see this, there are so many standards with respect to industry. I would just be amazed. In India, we have almost 30 standards, right? And 31, 32, 33, which have come on derivatives and financial instruments. But if you see in US, there are almost around 995 accounting standard codifications. Now, this is what will be there in your, what you say, in simulation and authoritative literature. Because a lot of them have asked me 50% MCQs and 50% SINs. On those SINs, you'll have all those authoritative literature where you need to read and answer the question. So we see that ASC 105, ASC 205, ASC 210 balance sheet, ASC 215 statement of shareholders' equity. Sir, what are these accounting standard codifications? Like in India, we have accounting standards which are governed, which tell you that how do you recognize an asset and a balance sheet, asset and a liability in the balance sheet. See, accounting is all about that, right? It's all about presentation. It's all about disclosure. It's all about how you present a thing in the balance sheet. Because at the end of the day, why are we focusing more on presentation, guys? Any answers? Yes, Ananya, Bhargavi, Chirag. Why are we much focused on the standard? Why are we doing this? First of all, why are we studying this subject actually? Yes. No, why am I talking on this particular front? First of all, why am I teaching you all this? So why are we doing this? For what is this users of financial statement? What are these accounting standard codifications? Why do we need all these things? To disclose true and fair view, for whom? Why investors? What will he do by seeing all these things? Stakeholders, what transparency? Why does he need transparency? What will he do by decisions? What decisions? To show how money is used. Whoever wants to invest, they need to see the financial statements. Decide to invest in the money, will decide about investing. These are the basic real position of the entity in which, since we need financial statement, need to know the status for buy or sell. Predictive values. Okay. Bahut bada naam hai, Gurpreet. Very, very dangerous thing which you have kept there. Predictive values for reporting and presenting the financial health of the company, position of the company, uniformity, consistency. As you see that, guys, when we started this session of FAR, we spoke about investors' perspective, right? So what we are doing here is basically to show that what is, so the investor is particularly concerned, because if you have kept money in your institute, right, you really want to kind of ensure that the organization or the institute faculties are really good, isn't it? Is that not the case? Because you have kept money into the institute, you just want to know that the services are really important, because that is where you have come into, and that's where you want to know that if that is something which is there or not, because your money will get wasted if the expectations are not met. All right, boss, my money is invested in a company. I am investing, whether even be a $5 or $1, it is end of the day very hard earned money, right? So my company in which I am investing, I will have to ensure that each and everything is clear on that particular source. Are you getting it? Everything should be clear, whether the asset, whether it be the liability, whether it be the notes to accounts, whether it be the annual report, each and everything should be transparent, because end of the day, my money is invested in this company. Now, why am I studying this financial accounting reporting subject? What should I do with this subject? This subject needs to be read from the investor's perspective, because if you don't recognize the asset properly, so you are losing out your money. If you don't understand how the assets and liabilities are presented, how can you invest in that company? Because end of the day, you read the balance sheet of the company and invest in the company. So there are various non-financial factors also. I completely agree. The debate is not whether it's a financial or non-financial factors, but at the end of the day, financial factors is such an important thing, because I want to see what is this company's profit? How is this company growing? Does it have any losses? What are the interest expenditures which it's paying? There are so many things I need to check it in the balance sheet, in the income statement, in the notes to accounts. Did they give their explanation or not? Most of the students don't have a habit of reading the annual report, don't have the habit of watching movies, Wall Street, just say, and all. Because please understand, guys, this subject is a passion related subject, right? You will have to read the annual reports. You will have to read the earning transcripts. You'll have to know that end of the day, you have invested in the company. So you will have to see what are those earning transcripts of the company. If I'll have to show you the earning transcripts of Apple, so many shareholders, they'll throw them apart. There are so many questions being asked about shareholders. What is your revenue from this division? How much you have made from India business? How much you have made from US business? What are you doing? Why did you recognize this one? Why are you paying more taxes? Why is that your revenue is showing more? What is that from month to month your revenue have increased? Why are there some extraordinary items? Why is that that provisions have been made? This quarter you have reversed those provisions. What is your accounting policy? Why did you recognize excess depreciation? Why did you create a method of depreciation on return on value? Why not straight line method of depreciation? Don't think that investors are fools. Please understand that, guys, they are not investing money like that. Warren Buffett reads 200 annual reports per day. I'm telling you guys, 200 companies research is going on in a day. He read those companies again and again and again and again. Every day, that is the literature that person reads. So that is a kind of richest investor we have, right? I think he's now in the fifth richest is our, any guesses, guys? Fifth richest is from our India only. Any guesses who's the fifth richest man now? Mr. Mukesh Ambani, right? So that is how it is. Now sixth richest have come to Warren Buffett. He was on the first ranking. Now in the first ranking, Jeff Bezos is there. Second, we have Bill Gates, right? So now fifth have come to Mukesh, right? So this is what it is. Why is Mukesh Ambani onto that? Because he's giving so much of money to the shareholders, right? He have created the wealth for shareholders. That's why he's wealthy. Right. So if you create wealth for your customers, the owner automatically becomes wealthy. It is same like an institute. If you create a great institute, Shripal himself becomes that one, right? So always remember to create value to your customers. And that is what is important when you're reading this subject, that if there is any misinformation, why am I talking so much? There are so many accounting frauds, which you'll see, which I will take you around when we go into consolidation, when we move into so many accounting policies, when we move into various depreciation methods also. You will not believe that so many US matlab, all companies, chore hai aade, listed companies, all doing all wrong methods, all the auditors trying to play around. So most of them, the companies try to use all those methods, right? So you will see the WorldCom fraud, Enron fraud. There is so a big movie on Enron, on accounting fraud. which have happened, you'll be amazed with the balance sheet presentation. I mean, hats off to the balance sheet presentation. I gave a session at IIM Sirmaur and Rohtak also on Enron fraud. I mean, derivatives. See, we are doing one. We had a JP Morgan interview for various our folks who have just joined with Simandar, and I forwarded, I said Sangeeta to forward those resumes. And these were the topics which I said them when I was talking to them. I said them to prepare on these topics, right? On the derivatives and all. These are very, very important. My favorite accounting standard codification, ASC 815 derivatives and hedging, and ASC 820 fair value measurement. So these are two subtle topics. I think Mandeep also asked one question in Telegram on ASC 820 on fair value measurement for highest and rich use, best use. So we'll come around this. So today is just a kind of, as a teacher, I'm just changing your perception of thinking about this subject. So today I'm not just going into much details, but changing your thought process about this subject, because I want you to understand, and apart from that, love this particular subject. So now this is the source, which is free, guys. I don't know if anyone have this link of this Deloitte. I hope this was there in the study portal, because there is no need to log in. You can just click on this link and kind of see this entire literature. Like that, you will have in IRS also, guys. So when you will read the US tax subject on regulation, same thing you will have. Just have the habit of reading the literature. It is asking for subscription. For me, it is showing free here. I have not paid anything, guys. Straight away, click on that link. You will go into that literature itself. It is free only. So what's the difference between ASC and US GAAP? They both are one and the same. They are actually the same only. So they are known as the accounting standard codifications only. So I think I'm signed up. So that's why it is showing. I'm not sure, because this is free, because I have not paid for this particular thing for sure. So I am sure on that particular front. I don't know if, can you kindly clarify, Sriram is asking, what we call them as US balance sheet or financial statement is still the same, since asset liabilities are coming vice versa in US. Presentation differs. You can use a horizontal balance sheet or vertical balance sheet, Sriram. So it's not a problem. Anything, we can do it. All right. No, we don't need to sign up. Just scroll down is what Amit is telling. Guys, just go there on that particular thing. Could sign up nahi hai. They are here. You can easily see the standard literature and all. If you're not able to see that, it is showing here, right? Oh, bhai, you don't need to kind of read this completely. These are just for your information, which is there, and contents and all. Right, you can go in and read here. It is all free. So you don't need to read all these particular things and go into all those, what you say, details. It's just for your information purpose, because tomorrow if someone asks you how many accounting standard codification are there, or what, how many US GAAP are there, you should be in a position to tell. Right, Becker haven't given you that because they have stick to exam pattern, but I wanted to tell you that entire details, that what is there and what is not there and what are you studying. And how many things are there, right? So it is there. It's free only, guys. I don't think so. They charge for anything as far as I know about Deloitte. See there, they have also given the, for exam point of view, of which ASC we followed. Everything Megha, you can relate. Now, when we come into revenue recognition, we will see ASC 606. So just for an example, guys. So people are talking that whatever are there in our portion, what Becker have given. So see there, ASC 606, when we will go into revenue, you will see ASC 606. Are you able to see this? ASC 606, if you see there is a, so revenue for recognition. So like that, whenever you'll go into each and every topic, relate with those standards. ASC 720, other expenses presentation. When you will go into income taxes, you will find ASC 740. You don't need to remember any names. But when you go into the interview, it looks very posh. You know what? Everyone asks you, you can tell, hey, sir, like AC 815, I went into derivatives and hedging kind of thing. So you can do some kind of overactions there. But in the exam, you really don't require to do any of that overactions. You can just learn the concept. It is a concept which is important, right? Nothing more than the concept, nothing more than the understanding. No memorizing the standard codification number. But yes, they will ask you in the exam to write the standard number and the codification. But there you will have the authoritative literature in your simulation. I will do one or two sims when we will go into that particular picture, where I'll show you how that ASC you can find out, ASC 815 and all. And if you permit me, I'll like at the end of the class, I'll show you how that literature also you can find out and kind of type there and write the according standard codification number. Because definitely one simulation will be research-based simulation where they will ask you to fill in the according standard codification number, ki which clause it is, which sub-clause it is. Now they'll give you consolidation topics, ask you whether which ASC it is, ASC 810 clause, sub-clause. Very, very easy, guys. Bahut hi sabse easy question. If I'll get, if you have 2-3 research-based sims, you should be a very lucky person as you God have kind of given you some kind of blessing. See, you can go to contractors. He'll ask you where is contractors coming? What is the background of contractors? So ASC 910, 810, and then 05, 15, 45. That is how you will write the codification. So if you want, I should show now only, I think, before talking on anything, because this codification is research-based only. If you permit me, I'll just straight away show you how to do this research-based simulation, because a lot of them were asking me this. So before going into the next 2-3 pages, I'll straight away show you how that research codification looks like, right? I hope everyone is on the Becker product. If someone who have gone into Becker product can help me around that, which chapter will have that, I mean, which simulation they have that codification. So I'm just checking if I can find one or two simulations which kind of talk about the authoritative literature. Yes, see this, guys. Is everyone able to see this? So see this, Bronson Company's accounting department is implementing a new general ledger software package. Can everyone open their Becker product? Is everyone, if they are seeing this, they can also open this. This is there in the PAR module 2, right? Module 2, question number 3, third sim. So if you see there, so Bronson Company's accounting department is implementing a new general ledger software package. The system provides definition that enables it to automatically segregate between current and non-current assets. The company has no clearly defined operating cycle. Which section of the authoritative guidance should Bronson use to determine the appropriate time period to use as a basis for classifying the current assets? The question is, so this is a very important thing. It's not like blindly going into authoritative literature and searching around. What is the concept here, guys? What does he want to find out? Just before that, current assets and non-current assets, when I'll go into, just for a small introduction, because everyone have said me to show one research-based simulation. So current assets are nothing that within 12 months, if your assets are converted into cash, they are known as current assets, or normal operating cycle, whichever is higher. So what is an operating cycle can be more than 12 months also. Like it might take more than 12 to 15 months to get converted into cash. That also can be called as a current assets. Are you getting that, guys? So even if it is more than 12 months, but it is within the defined operating cycle where you purchase, where you acquire something and that gets converted into cash, that is also known as an operating cycle. So what is an operating cycle? You purchase an inventory, then you kind of sell it that, and then you get the cash. So this entire cycle is known as an operating cycle. So what is the concept being tested here, guys? Understand the concept. It is understanding which will win you. So what is the concept? What is he wants to check us in the literature? What he wants me to check in the book, guys? See the question. I'll repeat again. Bronson's company's accounting department is implementing a new general ledger software package. So they want to implement this in software. Ki software hi bata de. What is a current asset and non-current asset, and define the time period also for that particular thing, right? So the company has no clearly defined operating cycle. Which section should Bronson use to determine the appropriate time period to use as a basis for classifying the current assets, right? So what is the time to classify the current assets? So we will go into the authoritative literature, right? So classification. So what is a keyword we must use? This entire game is won through what, guys? Keywords. All the answers in authoritative literature are run through keywords. Are you getting it? If someone doesn't type CPA, Simandar Education cannot come in Google. Does it make sense, guys? If you type Simandar Education, you might get so many Simandar Education. One Simandar Education, Idol is also there in Ahmedabad. Right? So Simandar Swami is in the name of the Jainism god, which is Simandar. Right. So if you type on Simandar education in Google, so it can show a lot of the Simandar things in that. What you need to type is CPA, then you will get a keyword. Right. So what is a keyword here and what should one search actually? So in this entire sources, as you know, in the beginning, I said you that which is a single source of authoritative literature for you guys. So what should I click there? That is why I taught you FASB first and then I went into the simulation straight away so that you can relate what is it. So can I click on the FASB codification? Shall I click on IRC? Why can't I click on IRC actually? Yes, why can't I click on IRC? What is IRC actually? I should know whatever I'm doing. This is for regulation subject. What is for PCAOB or auditing standard? This is for auditing. AICPA professional standard is for auditing ethical conduct. So what should I click on here? FASB codification. I went into FASB codification. View here. I went into FASB codification. Right. Now I'll search here. So what should I write? Classification of, I'll try everything, whatever I can. Classification of current assets. Okay. Now see this guys. What do we have? 210 balance sheet, 1045 presentation of kya hai yaar? Now tell me what should be the answer guys. I'm going here. If you see there guys, where did we went? AC 210. Is everyone able to see this Deloitte thing also? What is there in the Deloitte codification? Just to check whether Deloitte was right or no in the ASC codifications. See there ASC 210. Is everyone able to see the Deloitte tool also? I'm just going there into the Deloitte tool straight away. ASC 210 is what? Balance sheet. Is it not? Because he's talking about presentation. Now tell me guys, why is that presentation very important? Why should I see current asset and non-current asset separately? Yes. Why should I differentiate the current and non-current assets? Because we didn't went into the concepts, but since we have started this simulation, I don't want anyone to solve the simulation without understanding anything. Why should I differentiate between current and non-current? What will happen if I show non-current? What will happen if I show current? Are no finding working capital, nothing doing. We are investors. So should I not see the current assets? Because if there are so many non-current things, if the non-current is classified under current, people will think that what? A person who is investing in that company will think that this is a cash-rich company, right? Who are the lenders? Banks will lend on the current ratio. 2:1 ratio or not, debt to equity ratio. Yes or no, if he shows more current assets, right? More liquidity in the company, the bank will also lend him. Investors will be really happy that this is such a cash rich company. Kal agar kuch hua, toh they can sell the assets and they can give me cash. Is it not the case, guys? Entire subject must be read from investor perspective. Not to find out liquidity, solvency, all this is for whom? This is all for me. This is all for Shripal because he have invested in that company. So he should know that how much cash is there and how much cash is not there with the company, right? And if company is not having liquid assets, that means what? They are not able to pay the salaries to the employees. So if the company is not even able to pay salaries to the employees, where will it pay to the shareholders? Are you able to understand that? If a company have a good, what are the current liabilities of the company? If I have more current assets, that means what? What is shown in the current assets? Cash. I repeat again, guys, if I have more cash, can I pay that cash to the current liabilities or not? Can I honor the current liabilities? What are current liabilities? Salaries. Yes or no? They are like every month I need to pay salaries. Can I tell to those people, I will pay to you next year. You did a very good job. Now next year I will pay you your salary. Can we talk like that? These are our day-to-day operating expenses, trade payables. Yes. To your vendors, you have purchased something from your vendors, from your creditors, which have a period of 1 month to 2 months. Can I tell, I will take some books from you and I can tell Becker, come on Becker, I have taken a product from you. I will pay that after 2-3 years. Thank you. Bye bye. Goodbye. Can we talk like that? These are all real time things. I hope you are getting it. So you should have more current assets in your company so that you can pay. If you are not able to pay to your employees itself, to your creditors itself, how will you pay to your shareholders? Just understand, right? Microsoft is one of the cash rich company. Apple is one of the cash rich company, right? Google is cash rich. In India, you have Infosys as cash rich, right? You have Reliance Industries Limited, which have become net debt free today. I mean, so what is net debt free? They have more cash than their liabilities. So if I have to pay entire debt, I can be through my cash. I am known as net debt free because I'm showing cash also and I'm showing liabilities also at the same time. I'm not knocking off the liabilities, right? So that are known as net debt free. Anyways, coming back to the simulation, because I will, so this is known as net debt free as Bhagya is telling what is that which is there. So net debt free, that means what? You have more cash than your liabilities. That means what? More cash than your non-current liabilities. So that means what? He can actually cancel that non-current liabilities. He can pay off the entire debt, but he doesn't want to do. He just want to show that debt also, and he want to put the cash also, right? Sometimes having more cash is very good. I'll come when we go into the cash flow statement. You'll have some really fantastic time in your car, okay? Anyways, so what's the answer, guys? Fatafat, we both boldi have next. What is that? Where is that? So I'm not using, so we'll go back to that Sriram later. So right now, what is the answer? 210, 10, 45. I want the subclause also, even if they didn't ask. Some people are telling 45-1, 45-2. Incorrect. 45-1 nahi ho sakta. Why? 45-1 is talking about current assets definition. Hello, boss. How can 45-1 come? 45-2 is talking about, 45 subsection 2 is talking about prepaid expenses and all crap. 45-3. A 1 year time period shall be used as a basis for segregation. Okay. So okay, what is the answer, guys? Yes, Satish, Sabira, Ananya, Naga, 45-3, Simran, 45-3, 210, 10, 45-3. Let's see if we got this right or not. Okay. So let me see according standard codification, FASB, 210, 10, 45. Yes, we have got it, guys. Now tell me. How did you find this accounting standard codification? Is it so tough, guys? Yes, tell me this. Was it so tough? Or was it again based on concept, right? If there are concepts, now you don't need to solve so many authoritative literature research-based things also. Now what happens with a person who doesn't understand the concept? No, he will keep solving this 70-80 simulation and waste his time. Right, on this particular thing only, and he will do. Can we expect a simple question as a one-off whole sim? So every sim is like that only of research-based sim. It's all about the trick of getting the concept of that question. Are you getting it? The concept, even not the concept, even if someone knows what is the keyword, I would say keyword finding is very, very important. And I would say, I would give 70% weightage to keyword trick. Sir, these green ticks will also show even when your answer would be incorrect as well, right? No, it won't show actually. It won't show because if it's correct, then only it shows. Or do you want me to submit this? I think it shows that I have never solved any of these sims. So let me show the solution if it is correct. 210, 10, 45, 3. Even if it's wrong, it is showing, is it? But no worries. I'm not bothered about ticks and all because I was doing without seeing with you, with all of you. So 210, 10, 45, 3 is the answer. Okay, green tick is for the format. Thank you, because I have never solved any of these things from the Becker. This is the answer, guys. So we are right. So keyword is operating cycle. Becker I've showed, but what did we see? If someone sees the answer from Becker and try to solve on its own, he will never enjoy that. Never see the answer of any question when you're solving any of the FAR question, never see the answer. See, our keyword was different from him. So should we appreciate or not for that particular thing? Never ever see the answers. If you are seeing the answer, you will definitely fail the exam first time. Remember that. There is no doubt about it. Never see the answer, I'm telling you. I'm telling you, this is a final warning to everyone. Never see the answer and solve the question. Always try to do on your own. If you get it wrong, though, no worries, you can see the answer that time. But try to solve on your own till you don't get it, till you don't quit. Till you don't get the answer, don't quit. And once you find out, okay, now I'm not getting it right, I quit, and then you see the answer. If you keep seeing the answers and solving the questions, there is no purpose of solving this. There's no purpose of doing this entire thing. Always have that particular willpower in you that you can do without that also. No some sims, nothing doing Shalini, no sims. Not a single question should be done with seeing the answer. It should always be without seeing the answer and then try to see the answer if you have got it right or not. Okay, please stop this immediately, guys. I'm telling you. I hope I'm clear with this research-based sim. I hope it makes sense to many of them. Okay. Anyways, so back to my where were we? So now we have gone into some ocean and we have come across it. So that's how you need to relate, guys. Try to correlate what everyone is kind of asking and all and how the standard setting process are there. Now I'll go back to IFRS. So after this ongoing standard update, so FASB normally updates the accounting standards codifications and all sort of thing. And then next we come into our, so if you see there, ASUs are not authoritative literature, but instead provide background information about the codification and describe the basis for conclusions on changes in new codification. All new GAAP and SEC amendments are fully integrated into the existing structure of the codification. Sir, how much time we need to give for a research questions? I think 5 to 10 minutes is more than sufficient. Okay, what if two keywords are similar ASCs since they are given lengthy and irrelevant? So how we approach that within 1.5 minutes? You can take some time, Shriram. Even if you take some 5-10 minutes extra, don't panic in the exam. What is important is you get the simulation right. Answer should be right. That is what you need. If it is tough for you, it is tough for everyone. Remember that, guys. How we found out easy for that, it might be easy for everyone. If it is tough for you, it will be tough for everyone. It's a comparative based grading exam. It is not like it is easy for you and tough for all. It cannot be like that. If it is tough, it is tough for everyone. Clear? If half of the simulation is right, can we get marks for it? Yes, we get it. Okay. Anyways, just park these questions because right now I'm just focusing on PAR. So what is IFRS, guys? So very, very easy. So previously we had IAS, International Accounting Standards. There were 41 international accounting standard. Any guesses which country was the first one? I know some of them have seen my recorded videos also. They might have got that answer. But any guesses which is the first country which adopted the IFRS in the world? UK to hai. After UK, which was the first country? UK itself have done that. Bangladesh, yes. Some of them have actually listened to my recorded lectures and now they are showing off here by telling Bangladesh and all. I know you people would have never answered if you would have listening to the first time. Anyway, so Bangladesh was the first country which have adopted international financial reporting standards. So what have happened was IASB was established in 2001. We had international accounting standards. Still now we have IAS, which is 41 IAS. Now we have IFRS. The IAS word got changed after 2001 and it have changed into International Financial Reporting Standard. So sir, can I tell IAS and IFRS are one and the same? Yes is the answer. So they have just changed their name after 2001. So now they have changed it to IFRS. So as per my understanding, IFRS is UK GAAP, which we study in ACC and fully different US GAAP, right? What is the exact difference between them? So Megha, IFRS have also come into CPA also. We have everywhere US GAAP and IFRS difference. Because US GAAP have also adopted IFRS and they have conversed with IFRS on revenue, on leases, on a lot of them. Okay, so you will need to study that properly, the IFRS and the US GAAP differences also. And they will ask 3-4 MCQs only on the differences between US GAAP and IFRS. Very simple MCQs. You just need to learn the differences. Every chapter you will have those differences. So for US GAAP is applicable, then why we study IFRS? So Amit, there was a FAR. So if you see there, I'll come to the next pronouncement. So FASB and US GAAP, they ran a joint project. So US is telling that they will adopt IFRS from 2008. Since 2008, now 2020, they have still not converted the US GAAP into IFRS. See, every country is using IFRS. So US was also being pressurized that they must also use IFRS. They must not use US GAAP. Can anyone tell me reason why US is not adopting IFRS and why are they not converging completely into IFRS? Any reason, guys? Any logic why in US, when every country on this planet is using IFRS, India is using Ind AS, which is nothing but IFRS copy paste. So hamare wale to India always have eye on Queen Elizabeth. So they copy all whatever is there in UK, they'll copy paste here, right? So why are we not doing actually? What do you think? Why US is not doing instead of that? because of codification, it requires cost and time. Okay, what about others because of the currency? What a fantastic answer that is by Gurupreet. That is one of the masterclass answers. US GAAP is based on rules. It is not based on principles. Now, why is that? When you're, so this entire accounting standard today, what we are reading in US, guys, you will see that it is very, very rule based. When you will see IFRS, every chapter when I'll teach you guys, it will be more rule based and not logical based, right? So the problem with IFRS is very logical based, but when there is logic, there is always a debate to it. Are you getting it? Did you see that the people who are really intelligent, you cannot go along with them? So the persons who are very intelligent, no, they'll not talk to you properly, or they'll do their own overall kind of thing. They'll have their own specific mindset. So too much intelligence is sometimes very much harmful because you can't get along with them. Did you see the people who are uneducated? They are really fantastic people on this planet. Did you notice that? Because they are the ones who really don't mind whatever you tell to them. They'll never take on their ego. Even if you tell them you're stupid, they'll just won't react, right? But with an educated person, too much of education, right? Too much of logic, you just can't get along with those people because they'll keep using their mind in each and everything. And that's where, that is one of the disadvantage of logic, right? Because logic is something is that it always have a debate. It always have a separate angle or a second angle to it. But with rule based, you have actually kept that it is a rule you will have to follow. You can't adopt any logics to it. When it is a rule, it is a fact. And facts are like that. You need to follow that. There's no second thought to it. Now, US GAAP are always rule based. Wherever there was logic, they have adopted it, whether it be leases, whether it be revenue recognition, whether it be financial instruments. If you see ASC 606 of revenue is almost or what 100% similar to IFRS 15. ASC 842 of leases is simply completely similar to revenue recognition. Are you getting it? But wherever it is not required logic, they have followed rule-based approach so that no one can come and talk about it. Second important reason is the lobby of US companies. US companies don't want to follow IFRS because it is very much logical. Their presentation will change, but now they are being forced. Previously, a lot of airline companies in US were never showing operating leases on their balance sheet. If you are aware, guys, now operating leases are also shown on the balance sheet. I hope some of them who are reading leases or who have read FAR before, or who are seeing the Indian accounting standards or who have got an update. Previously in leases, we never used to show it on, we always used to show it in P&L account, operating leases. We never used to show it in the balance sheet, right? Now we are showing operating leases also in the balance sheet because US companies, the airline companies never want to show the debt. Because the moment you show it as operating leases on the balance sheet, you'll need to show as an asset and you need to always show a liability also in your balance sheet. So what you are showing as an asset, you also need to correspond with the liability. So airline companies didn't want to have more debt in the companies. When Suraj will go into leases, right? You will see that he'll explain fantastic in the leases concept. So just for your understanding, guys, Suraj is one more faculty who would support me in US onto FAR. He is one of the very, very favorite lecturers in Simandar Education. He is one of the All India Ranker One in Chartered Accountancy Examination. I've been writing papers. He has been with me in the Becker and writing the content for Becker. So we designed the questions for Becker on a per hour basis. So Becker pays for us. So that is our passive income which we give. So we give questions to Becker for CPA, CMA. So Suraj also supports me in that. So we are well versed with very good literature. I think I will be really happy. I mean, Suraj is taking up this time also leases, pension, some of the tougher concept is what Suraj will be taking care. So don't miss any of the classes, guys, from here on. Anyways, so this is one of the reason why IFRS is still there in the portion, because US wants that IFRS should be there in some of the places and they are forcingly the companies to adopt IFRS as soon as possible. But yes, they will never adopt IFRS fully because US is a dominating country. And that is one of the reason why people ask me, sir, why can't I do ACCA? Why should I do US CPA in India? Because everywhere US companies are there, US always dominates. Where there are US companies, there are always US jobs also. In India, we don't find any UK companies much, but US companies in every country, it will be there, in Australia, in UK, in US, in Canada. So that's where I always say that US CPA is more acceptable. That is a logic of telling that, not to just sell CPA course. I hope you are getting it, guys. Clear? Anyways, so now we have the SVAC number 8, which is a conceptual framework for financial reporting. Just to summarize, guys, we have read about US GAAP, the FASB accounting standard codification. Then we went into international financial reporting standard. There are 16 IFRS here, which Becker have not mentioned, but just for your information, 16 international financial reporting standards are there. Any guesses, guys, on the 17th IFRS, the latest IFRS which have come? Any guesses on the 17th IFRS? Just a guess. I don't want that. Insurance, correct. Bhai loga Google mein toh search nahi kar rahe na. IFRS 17 is the insurance which have been deferred to 2023. So don't worry, else you would have got a severe headache if insurance standard would have also been covered. Please remember, whatever IFRSs are there, same US GAAP also will be there in your content. So insurance is not there currently from 2023. As you know, there has been new updating CP exam from 2024. US CP exam will have 5 sections instead of 4. So the new standard got approved yesterday from NASBA and all. So there you'll have insurance, all sort of shitty things. So please remember that you clear your exam before 2022 itself. So next 2 years or 1 year only, right? Anyway, so SVAC number 8, conceptual framework for general financial reporting. You don't need to remember the SVAC number 8, right? Now, whatever I have taught you, you can all read all these things. You don't need to remember. This is just for your reading that primary users should read that. I have already spoken about who are the primary users of the financial statement, guys. Existing potential investors, lenders, creditors, they are the ones who use this financial statement, other parties, including regulators and all, right? What are the financial information provided in general purpose financial report? So see this, guys. So financial information need are included. So what are the reports? What are the financial information which is provided here is all the earnings, the growth, future cash flows. So these are all the information which is provided. Not much important with the exam perspective, just that you need to read that what all is the information which is being provided in the financial reports. Very, very important that you remember that financial information should be presented using the accrual basis of accounting. When you read any of the annual report of your company, you'll appreciate all those financial information. Guys, if you, I don't want to force anyone, just as a teacher, if you respect me, if I can ask you one thing, if you can just read an annual report today, I'll not force you. It's up to you because you are the one. I just don't want to force, but just if you want to listen to me or if you have a kind of thing where you want to explore this, I just expect that everyone kind of read one annual report only of Apple. Can you just respond yes or no if you are in for this? Only one annual report today of Apple. Just go to Google and you can find out Apple annual report, whether it be 2020 or 2019, last quarter also. Just read that. I don't want to force. If you are not in for it, no props, no forcing. It's completely at your end. But just that I want that you read that annual report once completely. Not that, even if you're not understanding, read it like a novel, but just read it as if you are investing in some company and just go through that annual report completely. Okay. Now the first multiple choice question is coming up after 40 minutes. I mean, 1 hour of my introduction about US GAAP and all. So this is the first MCQs which are coming up. Very, very important multiple choice question. This question is asked in exams like anything. Why, sir? Because these are the qualitative characteristics. They will confuse the students with this particular thing. What are the quantitative characteristics and what are the qualitative characteristics? A memorizing thing, but remember to understand that particular thing also. Now, what are the fundamental characteristics? Qualitative characteristic is that relevant and reliable. So Becker have given a mnemonic, but to be honest, guys, I never read the mnemonics because my problem is I forget the mnemonic only in the exam. So when I was preparing for the Becker, so I'm a Becker alumni. So when I prepared from the Becker and all, and I never read the, what do you say, the mnemonic, right? So the problem is we forget the mnemonic itself. So what are the famous mnemonics you remember and you can do it, but just don't force or pressurize on that particular thing, okay? Now this mnemonic, so what is a mnemonic for fundamental qualitative characteristic? Anything there? PCM. Right? So predictive, confirmative, materiality. So I have not put here also the mnemonic because I don't know what is a mnemonic here because I know, I think Peter have kind of used that in that in his lectures. So I'm not sure what is the mnemonic here we use, but I'm just underlining predictive, confirmative, and materiality. I'll just explain what are all this. So what are the fundamental qualitative characteristic is relevance. So first thing, the information what you are putting it is should be relevant and should be capable that the person can make the decisions. So first comes that the information should be having predictive value. What is a predictive value, guys? It can predict the future outcomes. That is what, is it an operating activity or is it a non-operating activity? Is it a continuing operation or is it a discontinuing operations? Your relevant information should be giving that predictive information. I hope you are able to understand. What is the second one? Confirmative value. So if I have given that information in the financial statement, does it have the same confirmations from the users also? It should not be something which is debatable or something which is not right. So it should conform to the user's information. Now, what are the examples of confirmatory values? Like you have recorded the accounting policy last year, you have followed this policy. This year also you have followed the same policy and you have confirmed that with the users. So the same thing. Materiality. Now guys, $5 paid to social security taxes, $5 I haven't paid. Is it a material amount? Yes. Naga is telling yes. Sheetal is telling yes. What is a Hiral is also telling yes. Why do you think so it is yes? Why it is material? Why are you telling no? Why are you telling yes? It is statutory. Yes, that's the answer, guys. $5 B or $1 B, what investors will think? They are not paying $5 also to the social security taxes. How will they pay my dividends tomorrow? Are you getting it? It's a big thing. If they are not paying statutory, they are not a corporate governance company. A corporate governance means what? They should always follow that. They should always pay taxes on time. They should always file the returns on time. Then only they are known as a corporate governance company. Infosys have so many awards. Microsoft have so many awards for corporate governance. Your reputation, your branding is everything done with your compliances, right? The more compliant company you are, the more branded you are. Are you getting this, guys? Don't take this all very lightly. Clear? So that is what it is. So some people are asking on confirmatory value. So Devika, don't get confused. Confirmative value is nothing but it is confirming whatever information you have passed and the feedback which you have received from the users. So it's just that whatever values you have given are not debatable and they are audited. Are you getting it? Once they are audited and all, because they are being evaluated by the users previously in their financial statement previously, again, they have been audited. So they are a confirmative values. Clear? So if omission will affect the decision making, then yes. Anyway, so I was on the statutory dues. So materiality is the material amount. So even if it is a $1, so by default, can I tell guys, anything which is there in your notes to accounts, do you know what are notes to accounts, guys? After your balance sheet and after your P&L and balance sheet, they give a notes to accounts where they tell you what is accounting policy they have followed, what are the disclosures. So all your disclosures are put into notes to accounts. As an investor, whenever I invest in stock market, guys, in India, I always have a habit of reading the notes to accounts. Even in CA exams, I don't know who all are chartered accountants, they will agree with me, or the non-CA or dropouts, that always we should write working notes. Why do we give so much stress on working notes? Because that are supporting. How did they arrive at the numbers? So always have a habit of reading the working notes. We are given, evaluated the most of the marks for the working note itself. That's why always read, always have the habit when you're reading the annual report, always see the explanatory statements or always read the whatever is the notes to statement. There you will find all the frauds. Getting it there, they will find all the issues and all. You might not know, there might be some case also against the company. Yes or no, guys? You can see that very clearly, right? And how can you find, guys, if there is a case against the company or not, even if they don't disclose in notes to accounts? Is there any way to find out that there is a case against the company? How can you find out with that? No, contingent liability, they might not disclose, Abhijit. In annual report, they might not disclose. In legal letter also, they might not disclose. How will you find out? Yes, Priyanka, that's a fantastic answer. In P&L, In P&L, they might pay something to lawyers or not, legal fees to the court. From that legal fees, the nature of legal expenses can help you find out that is there any case against that company or not. Good guys, I'm very, very happy that a lot of them have analyzed the financial statement so deeply. Right? Yes, there could be retainer fees or any of the consulting fees also. You can check in your P&L and you can find out whether there are any cases against the company or not, even though they might not have disclosed as per the materiality. Right? So I'm telling you again, it's not about the fundamental qualitative characteristic. As an auditor, you should be very careful. When you're reading the audit subject, you're lucky that I'm not teaching you audit. Neither I have broken you about with the questions. So audit is one of the fantastic subjects of CPA. Anyways, huge amount is suspense account. That suspense, that won't be such a big thing, but I think the legal expense is correct. Anyways, so predictive confirmating materiality. So for a 10 crore company, 1,000 rupees fraud or 1,000 rupees theft or a 10,000 rupees or a 1 lakh rupees also is not a material amount. Material amount is a one which can significantly influence the decision of the user. For a 10 crore company, 10 lakhs or 12 lakhs is a significant amount which can influence a decision. Are you getting it? So materiality is designed by the statements itself, and also it is at various levels how you design the materiality levels. If you read the audit, I think you can understand what is materiality more, because we design materiality. So just on a perspective, guys, for an IT company, where will you put a materiality? Will you put a materiality on profits? Whether you'll put a materiality on your assets? Because you will have to put some percentage of your materiality and do a materiality audit. Are you getting it? For an IT company, on what basis you will put a materiality? It will be on the particular aspect. Yes, is it based on value or a particular aspect? Yes, Sriram, it is based on aspect. EBITDA on a profit. So let me tell you guys, on an IT company, the materiality, who decides the materiality in the accounting? Our auditors decide the materiality, right? And they are the ones who would tell that what is material amount, right? So, but if it's low amount fraud also, it's material, I think, because fraud shows integrity. Wasim, fraud interns done by employees, they will not take care much. So that is not so relevant for me, 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees. Statutory dues are very important for me. 10,000, 20,000 fraud, 1 lakh computer someone have taken out, in Microsoft, it's not such a big deal. Software licenses, contract value. So typically the materiality in IT companies is based on revenue, because in IT industry, every investor sees the revenue. They see the top line. Remember guys, that's why I was telling you that you should always be in stock market, in capital market group, which we have created. You must see the quarterly results when they declare. So what is a material thing there? Their revenue. Because every investor sees what is a top line. In Amazon, do you see profits or do you see revenue? In e-commerce companies, guys, fatafat bolo, in e-commerce companies, do we see profits or do we see revenue? All the e-commerce companies are in losses. Are you getting it? So do you think, sir, investors are fools to invest in that? Sir, why are they investing in e-commerce companies when they are making every now and then losses? Please understand, they want the market share. See now how Reliance did. Shall I tell you guys what is a Reliance concept, if everyone is aware? First, Reliance came out with a Jio, right? When they came with Reliance Jio, they gave everyone free. Yes or no? They took huge depth in the market. They took huge depth from the market, and they gave everyone free Reliance Jio SIM for 10 months to 11 months. After they got all the subscribers, against that subscribers, they went to Facebook, they went to Google, they went to Microsoft and said, see that I have a huge market share. You invest in our company. They took their money only and they knocked off their debt from the balance sheet and became a debt-free company. Are you getting it? Am I clear with Reliance strategy? It is known as market penetration strategy. Is it clear, guys, what I've explained? Are you able to understand? This is known as market penetration strategy, which is being used. For an e-commerce companies, that's why revenue is such an important thing. First, you give something free. First, you shell out, get the market share, and then charge from the people, and then change it to profitability. Clear? Anyways, Amazon is still into losses in India. In India, mein kya hai? Sabko free chahiye. So no one can get profit in India from e-commerce companies. They want offers. They want discount. Some people, they don't want discount. They want free only. when they talk to e-commerce companies, they don't even want 90% discount. They want all free. Pura focus on India mein sabko. Free rahe to is they will conduct. So that's how apam these e-commerce companies, sorry to say, but they are not making any profit in India. India, they are very price sensitive market. They want all discount, 70% discount, 100% discount. So like that, some of them, they take coupon vouchers. If they are not giving, they have lost entire. That's what Reliance knew. That's why they gave all free first 10 months. Because they knew a 60%, 70% discount won't work in India. Give all free only. Then the market will come to you. Okay. Anyways, the next thing is that's why only an Indian can understand the Indian sentiments, not the foreigners. That's why Amazon couldn't succeed in India, but Reliance have done that. If Amazon is on losses, why are they hiring too many people and giving them huge packages? Amazon India have said, Amazon Global has huge profits. Neha, they have their cloud business. Amazon have their own AWS, which is giving us huge profits. So Amazon is such a company. I have given session in Amazon. If you've seen the website, I have given an Amazon session in Bangalore and Hyderabad. When I was talking to Amazon heads, they were telling Sripal, why are we proud of Amazon is even after every year they grow with 20%, even being a $250 billion company, every year they are growing at 20% growth. I mean, this is huge, guys. I mean, just imagine you are just, see, if you're a 10,000 crore company and if you're growing at 10%, I can understand if you're a startup. But Amazon is such a huge company and still it is growing at 10 to 20%, I mean, double digit growth. Hats off to Amazon. There's a huge thing, right? Anyways, so this is about predictive confirmative materiality. Why am I giving you so many examples is you should always remember the materiality concept with industry wise. So IT industry, it can be on revenue. E-commerce company can be on revenue. What about infra companies and power companies, guys? What do you think? Will it also be on revenue? So normally as an auditor, when I was in EY, so it will always be on assets. Yes, that's right. How many power companies, how many they have got asset based is the power company. Very, very good. I mean, the crowd here is fantastic with their industry knowledge. Very good guys. Nitin, Vinita, Sadan, superb. Maza aega bas par mein. I'm getting some good answers in my lectures. Anyways, faithful representation is, so first one is, so first uniform fundamental characteristic is predictive, confirmative, materiality. Predictive is it should predict the EPS, it should predict the future, it should conform with the audit reports from the evaluations made in the past. Third is the materiality. Second comes the faithful representation. So relevance and reliability. So first is relevance. The information should be relevant. And second, it should be faithfully represented. So one is complete. It should be complete from all the information necessary. Second is neutral. Third is free from error. I don't need to tell you on this particular thing. These are the big words, but none of the US companies, or I would say only 20% of the US companies follow this. Rest all are doing only fraud, whether it be Toshiba, whether it be WorldCom, whether it be Enron. Lately, there were so many companies, insurance companies doing all these things, though it is there, but I think now they are being more strict with Sarbanes-Oxley's Act. I see internal control, which has been adopted. And that's one of the reasons why we brought certified internal audit course in Samandar, because internal audit is such an important thing these days because of the so many frauds. So CFE, which is certified fraud examiner, these courses, though we don't do CFE, but these are very, very good courses here. I mean, because of this particular thing where they don't follow all this faithful representation thing. That's why you need to appoint fraud investigators, internal control things, CPAs in your company to check whether the information is complete or not. How do you check complete or not? So what happens? How do you check the completeness of rent? I know some of them might have attended our audit class. How do you check whether the rental expense is complete or not in your, because he's talking about complete. How do I check whether what you have recorded, that rent expense, is right or not? Correct. Agreement. So you will check agreement, whether in that agreement, that rental, and that is a basis to check whether the in expenditure, what you have recorded in P&L is complete or not. Always check the agreement and find out. So this is about complete information, not only with respect to line items. So I've just given rental as an expenditure, but to all the information should be complete. Whether it be contingent liabilities, everything should be disclosed. Second is neutral. It should be free from bias and selection and all. So no unbiased information to influence some investors. Third should be free from error. So should not have perfect accuracy, because some of the provisions are based on judgments, right? So we are not looking like complete or accurate and all, but it should be free from error. That means there should not be errors in at least in the processes or in the accounting policies. That at least we can expect, right? Judgments may error, I can understand. But normal small policies, it should not be an issue. So what are the, yes guys, without saying what are that, what are the fundamental qualitative characteristic? First one, yes. What are the fundamental character qualitative characteristics? First one is what? Relevance. Under relevance, what all will come? Comparability. Yes, under relevance, what all will come? Predictive value, confirmative value, and materiality. PCM. Please confirm material is the mnemonic what Shalini have given. Please confirm material. So under relevance, predictive, confirmative, and materiality. Under faith, and the second is faithful representation. What would come under faithful representation? Complete. Please type, guys, so that you remember everyone. Complete, neutral, and error-free under faithful representation. Once you have understood the logic, you just can't enjoy. Are mai to enjoy kar liya subject, very nice, I have understood it. No, after understanding, you should memorize it. Unfortunately, what happens is people memorize and then try to understand. No, first understand the concept and then memorize it so that you have a good hold over the topic. So what I have been doing in my lecture is first making you logical and then making you memorize. So what is that? Relevance and faithful representation. Under relevance is predictive, PCM. Under faithful representation, complete and neutral. Is there any other mnemonic, guys, which I have not read in Becker? If you can share, feel free to share in the chat window. Nothing is there, right? Okay, good. So next comes the enhanced qualitative characteristic. Enhanced qualitative characteristics, see the difference. One is fundamental qualitative characteristics and second is enhancing qualitative characteristic. One is comparability. So you should be able to compare, because you cannot have Apple adopting something different standard and Microsoft adopting something different standard, right? So accounting should be consistent, should be comparable, right? So that is the enhancing qualitative character. That's not a yes, previous year versus current year, the accounting policy should be consistent. Second is verifiability. What is verifiability? It should be verified by an independent observers and reach a depiction that a particular, like you have an actuary which has been appointed to check the gratuity valuation, right? You have auditors, right, to check whether the information is faithfully represented. What is timeliness? So timeliness means what? You are reporting the balance sheet and P&L on a timely manner, right? On time, your quarterly reports are going. See what happens, no? I'll tell you guys. I remember Dewan Housing Finance Limited of India had just deferred their quarterly results by 1 month and the stock fell down by minimum 20%. So investors can take it very negatively when you postpone the results. They think that are kuch ho gaya kya? Is there some big issue which have come? Please understand, you are reading this subject from whose perspective, guys? Investor's perspective. So please be information timely. You know what? When I used to work in Infosys, because I give so many examples, because I worked in Infy, I worked in EY. So when I was working in Infosys, Naren Murthy is there. So he was the one who said, was the first one who used to come out in the stock market and declare the results and used to give the guidance, right? That's why Infosys was a darling of stock market, because they were the first one who come out in the market and declare the results. Because people think that they are so confident that they are coming first. So every month on the beginning of the 7th, they used to declare the results. Mohit is not able to hear me. Is others also facing that? Are you guys not able to hear me? Because my internet is working very nicely. Okay. Anyways, so fifth come is the understandability. So information is understandable if it is classified, characterized, and presented clearly and concisely. So guys, first, so kuch bhi information nahi de sakte. People should be able to understand that also, right? So your understandability is also a very, very big factor. So comparability, verifiability, timeliness, and understandability are enhancing qualitative characteristic. They have given a numeric compare and verify in time to understand it. Is it clear to everyone? These is enhancing qualitative characteristics. Next comes the cost constraint, aspect number 3. So what are the characteristics of non-business organization? So this is not so important, but still I'll go off for, this is for governmental and non-governmental accounting. If you permit me, I'll cover this in F8, F9 and F10, and you can just, I think I'll just not confuse you and I'll leave it for time being, because this is there in F8, F9, F10. So I'll just tell you to skip around this for today, because this is something which we'll cover in the later chapters. So aspect number 5 is full set of financial statements. So you have balance sheet, statement of financial position. So when you go into interview, please don't tell balance sheet, income statement. It will look really idiotic. Please be posh. When you talk in an interview, in your studying, you can definitely tell. But in your interview, sir, you know what? So full set of financial statements are statement of financial position, statement of earnings, statement of comprehensive income, statement of cash flows, statement of changes in owner's equity. See, interview wale ko bhi pata hai. Financial position means balance sheet. But your poshness shows that, are bhai, in bada aadmi hai, we should hire him. Are you getting it? So always use some good nomenclature. Have that habit of reading, because tomorrow you will become partners or CFO. You cannot use the word balance sheet, income statement. Use a words called as statement of financial positions. So statement of earnings. Hey, you know what? What are the statement of our earnings? Where are we on our earnings when you go to VP level? So have that habit of talking like that. Statement of comprehensive income, statement of cash flows. We'll go to the comprehensive income later. Statement of cash flows, statement of changes in owner's equity. So these are the two things which you have not seen in your India. One is the comprehensive income, which is known as unrealized P&L. Did you see that in India, when we don't sell something, we don't recognize that profit or losses? That is known as unrealized. So now in India also, we have brought something called as comprehensive income, which is nothing but unrealized profits or losses, right? So mnemonic again, they have given PUF. So in India, there is Ind AS now, which is converted with IFRS. Now they are also preparing comprehensive income. Previously, we never used to have comprehensive income. Now in India also, we have comprehensive income. Till now, banks have not adopted Ind AS. So I hope once they adopt that, we'll have more opportunities under IFRS also, where we use the comprehensive income concept. Yes, that's what Hiral is telling. So balance sheet, income statement, comprehensive income, cash flows, and changes in owner's equity is nothing but how much shareholders shares were given, what is the dividend, they reconcile that. It's a reconciliation statement, which is prepared in statement of. So full set of financial statements is statement of financial position, statement of earnings, what is PUF there. So anyways, so statement of cash flows, so cash flow statement, balance sheet, P&L, and statement of changes in owner's equity. How much your equity share cut, any rights issue were issued, any common stock, may any of these APIC was done. So that's a reconciliation statement. Okay, next is the fundamental recognition criteria. So measurability, relevance, reliability, we have already read about it. So what all comes under relevance, guys? Quickly. Yes, what all comes under relevance? Fast, fast. Don't even see. Tell me fast. Relevance, mein what all comes? Patapat type there. What BCM? Type there. No short forms. What is coming under relevance? Predictive, confirm, and materiality. Yes. What all comes under faithful representation, guys? Faithful representation. Complete, neutral. Yes, faithful representation. Complete, neutral, and free from error. What all comes under enhancing qualitative characteristics? Comparability, verifiability, timeliness, understandability. Thank you. Okay. Now next comes the measurement attributes for assets and liabilities. So assets and liabilities are typically items reported in financial statements are currently measured using different. So PP&E is measured at historical cost. Inventory is measured at cost, right? Typically in India, inventory is measured at cost or NRV, whichever is higher. But in US, inventory is measured at cost. Getting it? Accounts receivable is measured at net realizable value. Marketable security, which will go around, is held for trading, available for sale, is measured on current market. Bonds, notes are measured at present values. Are you getting it? They can ask this in simulation. Please be very careful. PP&E is always measured on historical cost. Inventory is measured at current cost. Accounts receivable is measured at NRV. Market security or term security and AFS is measured on current market value. Bonds and notes are measured on present value of the future cash flows. So that's how it is being governed. So what are the fundamental assumptions actually? So these are the assumptions, entity assumption, business entity assumption, going concern assumption, monetary unit assumption, periodicity assumption, measurement principle. Okay, so now tell me guys, why are we showing share capital in the balance sheet, which is nothing but common stock? Yes, why are we showing share capital, common stock? So I'm just going into the second chapter because I want to show you the balance sheet, how it looks like, because we need to see how the balance sheet looks like in the US GAAP. Yes, why are we showing, so you can do liability asset also, you can do asset liability also. Don't follow this format, either ways it is fine. Why are we showing this total stockholders equity capital stock? Why are we putting on liability side? Now we'll go on to last 15 minutes on each and every line item. Because people said, a person who is very new to accounting, you should know first of all, what is a balance sheet, right? In balance sheet, what are the line items? What is this stockholders equity? Why it is shown on the liability side? Yes. What is a concept? Business entity concept, entity assumption. So you guys be on the first chapter only, guys. So I'm just telling you the logic behind all those concepts. One who have read the first chapter can master the entire accounting. He can do anything. One who knows the concepts in accounting can solve anything in accounting. Only first 10 pages one need to read. That's it. That is enough for solving accounting. Okay. First concept coming up. Why are we showing capital in the liability side? Because it's a separate legal entity. Why, sir? Because your company is different and your shareholders are different, right? You are preparing the balance sheet in whose name? In the company's name. For company, they are liable to their shareholders. That's why it is being shown on the liability side. I hope it makes sense to everyone. So cash put into the capital. What is a journal entry? Patapat. Yes, quick. I don't have much time. Cash put into the capital. What is a journal entry? Which should be debited, which should be credited? Quickly, cash account debited and capital account credited. Why, sir? Why is cash account debited? Golden accounting principles of accounting. They will ask a lot of journal entries in PAR. Don't take it as a joke. I know that people might be thinking, what is Sripal teaching here? This is very basic and elementary. For me, this is my core. Yes, cash follows which concept? Real account. Cash is a real account. Debit what? Comes in, credit what? Goes out. Capital account is a nominal account. Is it a nominal account? Capital account is a nominal account, yes? So debit the benefit receiver, credit the benefit giver in the capital, right? So that's why I have put cash into the business. So cash is coming in. I have given credit to the capital because capital is something called as in a personal account in such form. And if someone doesn't understand the real or the golden accounting principles, who can just put it in Google, guys. Just today, if you are non-accounting background, if you are very new to accounting, just type in Google golden principle rules of accounting. What are those three principles, right? One is a personal account, one is a real account, third is the nominal account. If you don't understand that also, liabilities is always credited, so capital is credited in that case because we show capital on liability side. Debit asset, credit liability, as simple as it is. Clear? But sometimes when you discharge the liability, you will debit it. So that's why you need to be very careful. Liabilities always shows credit balance. When you discharge the liability, it becomes what, guys? Debit balance. Is it clear? Like sundry creditors here. So I am done with the stockholders equity. So what is capital stock? Common stock means share capital. What is preferred stock means preference share capital. Clear? India mein common stock ko share capital bolte. US mein it is known as common stock, preferred stock ko preference share capital. Paid in capital is nothing but securities premium, guys. Additional paid in capital. So securities premium in India, in US it is known as APICs. Retained earnings and accumulated other comprehensive income also is shown separately. That is known as OCI, that is unrealized profit and losses. So that is shown separately under the liabilities. I will go into OCI later. Right now, I am just doing this. Okay. So I hope you are able to understand that. Clear? So this is the equity approach. This is my equity of my balance sheet. So this is the line item which shareholders ka area hai ye. Shareholders ka adda hai. Are you getting it? What do you mean by adda? This is their area. Common stock, preferred stock, paid in capital, accumulated other comprehensive income. These are the ones which are shown on the total liability side, on the stockholders' equity. Is it clear, guys? Adda means rendu. Okay. So I am not well versed with Telugu, though I am from Hyderabad. So anyways, so long-term liabilities. So what all comes under long-term liabilities, guys? Bonds payable, deferred income tax liabilities, and pension and other post-retirement benefit liabilities. So bonds payable are what, guys? What is bonds? They are nothing but like debentures. Like in India, we have debentures. In US, they are known as bonds. So nothing but when someone wants to issue money in the raise money from the market, right? There is a separate market which is known as, apart from equity market, there's something called as bond market also, where you can raise the money from the bond holders. So what you need to pay to the bond holders, you will need to pay the interest to them, right? And at the maturity, you need to pay the principal to them. Is it clear, guys? You have a separate chapter of bonds, right? So bond acts like a normal, aap log bahar jaake kaise lend, kisse paise lete, like you lend from your friend, right? You take money from your friend, you pay him interest also, you pay him actual amount also. That is a different thing, that you don't pay anything to him. You tell him that I'll give you tomorrow, day after, and tomorrow never comes to your friends. So we see that, right? A lot of the friends, they tell, yeah, I'll give you a loan and all, 1 lakh, you pay me interest, and then you pay me back later with interest. So you never pay him principal amount, you never pay him interest also. That is how bond market is, but it is an organized market. Your friend's money is unorganized. So that's why it will come as, like in as a normal current liability or other liabilities. It will not come as a long-term liabilities, as a bonds liability. Clear? Okay. So long-term loan from bank also come under long-term liability? Yes, Ankit, that's also correct. So now when I'm paying off this liability, should I debit or should I credit? Journal entry, quickly. When I'm repaying the loan, what is a journal entry here? What debit? What should I debit? What should I credit? DRCR bol rahe kya? Debit what? Debit bonds, not debit bond. Debit bond payable. Right? Sir, abhi to aap bole liability always show credit balance. Abhi debit kyun kar rahe sir liability ko? When we are discharging the liability, doesn't it take a form of asset now? So that's why we are debiting loan, crediting the cash. When you are knocking off the liabilities, so liabilities always shows what balance, guys? By default, always shows credit balance. When we are knocking off the liabilities, it always shows debit balance. Getting it? So one more is unearned revenue. So if someone have given you, so you have received the cash. So interest received in advance. What is a journal entry, guys? Interest received in advance. What is a journal entry? What should be debited? What should be credited? Interest received in advance. Quick, quick, quick. Bonds payable is a liability, Rahul. Yes. What is a journal entry for interest received in advance? Cash account debit. Credit is what? Interest received or interest received in advance? Some of them are telling interest received. Incorrect. If you tell interest received, is an incorrect answer. I have said you that journal entry for interest received in advance. So what is a journal entry? Cash account debit and interest received in advance credit, sir. Why so much of stress on interest received in advance? Why like that? I'm telling that because interest received in advance is a liability. Interest received is an income. Are you getting it? Interest received in advance is a liability. Still it haven't come to you. Right? It have just that the money have come to you, but you will still have to kind of negotiate, and the due date pay, you will have to recognize it. So as per accrual concept, you'll still have to recognize it, but right now you will show it as liability. When you realize it, you will recognize that as a, you'll recognize that as earn, right? So interest account debit not advance interest account. Interest, if you debit it, it will become an expenditure. Hello, boss. Are you getting it? So interest received in advance will be credited, which is a liability. It will be shown there because it's a liability. Now tell me, if I have received cash, normal cash received from a supplier, you will show cash account debit and you can show advance payable as credit, or you can use the supplier name. So you can use the creditor name or you can use advances payable also. So please be very careful on these sort of journal entries. These are very, very tough journal entries. Are you getting it? Because, sir, why are we showing? Because, see, aaj main agar aap se, guys, just to summarize this, I have received 5 lakhs from Shalini, for an example. Right? Shalini said, sir, I'm giving you 5 lakhs and you will have to kind of do this construction for me in the next 2-3 years. So can I take that 5 lakh and run away and show it as my revenue? And can I do like that, guys? Ye 5 lakh leke pocket mein leke bhag jana kya? No, please understand. Is he liable to perform the services or not? That is the concept of accrual. Are you getting it? Accrual tells us that, see the next concept in your first chapter, entity assumption, going concern assumption, right? We have something called as next thing, fundamental assumptions and principle, that is known as accrual accounting. You are yet to perform the services there. So cash account debit, credit, advances, or Shalini, whoever it is, right? So always remember that accrual services tell that the moment you perform the services, then only you can recognize that as in your income. You haven't performed the services, that's why you are showing it as your liability. So you are liable to perform the services. So cash account debit, credit is Shalini. Simply not running away money and recognizing revenue in your P&L. Ye kya koi mazak hai kya? Taking 5 lakhs and not performing services. They can put a court case also against you, right? So cash account debit and liability will be credited. The moment you perform the services, liability will be knocked off and revenue will be credited. You will recognize revenue to that extent. I hope I'm clear what I'm talking today on my very first class. Clear? I hope I'm making sense to people what I'm talking, and I hope I'm not fast. I'm going very little slow on each and every assumption with one line item, and I'm trying to relate with each and every entity assumption. Now third, why should we record depreciation in P&L account? Yes. Freshta, very, very easy. Again, I'm explaining you Freshta. Don't get confused. If you have received money, cash will be debited or not, Freshta, because you have received the money. So cash account will be debited. Credit you cannot put as an income because you need to perform the services. She has paid you advance. Are you getting it, Freshta? So you will recognize that as a liability and you'll credit the liability account. But the moment you perform the services, what you will do is you'll credit the liability and debit the revenue. I hope you're getting it. Okay. Now, what was my question? I just forgot what I asked actually. Sorry. Depreciation. Yes. Why are we recording depreciation expense in P&L? In the income statement, matching is a concept. Very good. Why are we recording closing stock under trading account on credit side? Did you see in your elementary, intermediate or classes, you always used to write buy closing stock on credit side? Yes or no? Which concept are we dealing? Again, matching. Are you getting this is matching concept? You are recognizing your expenses with your income. So income statement mein closing stock is coming on the credit side. Even though you're not getting any money, why are we putting as an income in your statement? Because of the matching concept, that income you will generate in the future, right? So anything. So what is the definition of an expenditure, guys? What is the differences between expenses and expenditure? I've also said many times in my earlier classes, I don't know if someone have read my recorded classes. What is the difference between an expenses and expenditure in your income statement? We are going into income statement and relating it with the balance sheet. Expenditure we normally use for capital item, right? Expenses we normally use for revenue item. Is it clear? Expenses is normally used for revenue and expenditure is always used for assets. That's why we tell no capital expenditure, I purchase asset. So expenditure and expenses is very, very different in its approach. Now, what is the definition of expenses or expenditure? Anything which is, so what is the definition of expenses, guys? What do you mean by expenditure? Okay, some of them have read this. Anything which is consumed is known as expenditure, Ekta, not consumed, no. Anything which is consumed is an expenditure. Anything which is not consumed is what, guys? Suppose for an example, just hang on there, no answers, just wait. Raw materials, just follow me. Raw materials, when they are consumed, does it become an expenditure or not? Do we write two raw material consumed in our income statement or not? The material which I am consuming, two raw material consumed, do we write or not? The raw material which I have not consumed, like I have brought 30 t-shirts, 28 I have sold. So I have written consumed, the two which I haven't sold. What is that? Anything which is not consumed is what, guys? Closing stock. So can I classify that anything which is not consumed is an asset or not? Yes or no? Anything which is consumed is an expenditure. Anything which is not consumed is an asset. Insurance is a classical example. Insurance, when it is prepaid insurance, is an asset or not? Because that insurance we have paid in advance, but we haven't consumed it. Is it clear, guys, what I'm talking? Anything which is not consumed is an asset. Insurance expenditure, when consumed, becomes an expenditure. I hope I am making sense. Any expenditure in advance is an asset. Yes, Abhishek. You can call it like that, because that expenditure I have not consumed. So that's why it becomes an asset for me. I hope I'm making sense on each, and these all are not there in Becker, guys. I hope you guys are focusing. Uno kuch bhi nahi batayega book mein. That's why we are taking it here. So nothing will be given. Why asset? Why liability? What is journal entry? They'll not explain all this. So that's why please focus on this class and understand what is it. Right? Anyways, so current assets, current liabilities. So already I've spoken about current assets. If you see on the liabilities front, we are talking about accounts payable, notes payable, interest payable, salaries payable, unearned revenue. We have covered all these items. Now, what is this? So this bloody sir, everyone keep on. I know Amit is also there, one of the senior members here in our lecture today. I think Amit will also relate with me that accrual is one of the toughest concept, right? So now accrual ka, now because we have a salaries payable in the current liabilities, guys. If you see there, again, Sneha have also asked me. So I'll give a lot of examples, Sneha. Don't worry about consuming and not consuming. So now salaries. Salaries, January ka salary, when do you pay, guys? Guys, January salary, when do you pay? February, right? So should I record expenditure in that month, or should I record that expenditure in February? Like suppose March salaries, we pay it in the which month, guys? March salary, we pay it in April month. Should I record March salary in the March month, or should I record it in April? Because April I am paying the salary, right? So should I record in March, or should I record it in April? Saranya is telling April, Nidhi is telling March. Irfan is telling March. Why should I record in March? Why can't I record in April? Salaries of March. Why can't I record it in April? What's wrong if I record it in April? What's wrong if I don't record it in March? No accrual concept. Concept. What is the logic of that concept? Why should I not record it in March? Why should I not record it in April month? Please understand, guys. Forget about the concept. Agar, please understand that because he have rendered the entire month that services or not, strictly talking, if that person resigned in March month, should I not make the payment on the March month or not? Yes or no? I have given the entire services of March month. So I should record the expenditure also in that particular month or not? Irrespective whether I paid or not, the moment I render the services, what is the logic, guys? I should record that as an, the moment I render the services, I should record that as an expenditure. Is it not the same concept of revenue also? Just now, Farmesh was asking me, sir, I didn't get cleared with that cash received in advance. Is it the same logic or not for revenue also? Till I don't render the services, am I allowed to recognize revenue? Guys, Till I don't render the services, am I allowed to recognize the services? Yes or no? No. No is the answer. Till I don't give the services, I am not allowed to recognize revenue. Till I don't render the services, I am not allowed to recognize expenditure also. Here salaries month, they have rendered the services. So I should record that as an expenditure in my P&L. No, Prudence, Uden. Simple concept, guys. Don't worry. Nothing doing. First of all, don't stop these all assumptions. What you have, Prudence. I didn't even went to Prudence. Just be in present. When I'm teaching, don't go to past. Don't go into future. I know your mind is like that. The moment we are talking, it will go either in past or it will go in future. Try to be it as is in the present. That's why I'm making it very interesting so that you don't even think what is going on beyond that. Clear? Just staying present. Right now, what we are talking, guys, accrual concept. What is an accrual concept? The moment you render the services, you should recognize the expenditure in that particular month only. The moment you render the services, you should recognize the revenue also. Now you have received advance money. You cannot recognize that as an revenue. Cash mila to tumhare revenue ke liye nahi hai wo. You should render the services. Then only you can recognize that in your P&L. Till then, it will be shown under liability side. Cash will be debited. Liabilities will be credited. I hope I am clear on this particular thing. Okay. Next. So anything which is consumed is known as expenditure. Is it not, guys? Now my classical logic of this of accrual concept. Now same with the consumption and non-consumption, because someone asked me that they're not clear with consumption, like Ekta, right? She said, sir, what is this consumption, not consumption? Agar if I have rendered the full services in that month, is my services consumed or not? Everyone, March month I have rendered the services. Is my services consumed or not? So can I record that as an expenditure or not? Yes or no? Yes, so that's why I have consumed that expenditure. So I have written that as an yes. Is it clear to everyone? Are you able to understand? So salaries will be debited and credited would be what? Salaries payable. Sir, why didn't you credit cash? Yes, Farin, Shrikala, salaries is debited. So something which is consumed is an expenditure. So I debited the expenditure. Why did I credit salaries payable? Why didn't I credit cash, guys? Because I didn't even pay cash. We don't follow cash basis of method. Cash, so I am paying in which month, guys? April month. I am not paying it in March month. So that's why. But I should record that. Sir, then why are you telling me to record that expenditure? That's what I am telling, guys. I have rendered that services. That's why I need to record that expenditure as per accrual concept. So cash, so expenditure is debited. Credited will be expenses payable. Clear? And next month, what will be the journal entry, guys, in the April month? Quickly, what is the next month journal entry? Salary payable will be debited and cash will be credited, right? The moment I will knock off the liability, the moment I pay off with the cash, my liability will get knocked off. I hope you are able to understand whatever I was talking today. 9:09, we are just 6 minutes. I hope you are not finding it very boring, because I could only complete one module, because my logic was, it's not about completing the portion, but it is about understanding the subject. Why cash? Why not bank? Are cash and bank, you can write, Akash, no worries. You can always write cash and bank. There is no worries. Normally you should use cash and bank rather than cash, right? Anyways, so last 5 minutes I have so that I can close off this balance sheet with all the concepts. Sorry guys, I'm taking a little bit. Sir, what is this accrual and deferral? Accrual means you're accruing that. Deferral means you are not recognizing that. Why are you not recognizing, like revenue? Why are you, so you have received money in advance, Siddhant. Can you recognize that as an revenue? Siddhant, can you recognize that as an revenue? You cannot recognize. So you're deferring it. Deferring means what? You're delaying it. Next year when you consume the services, that time you will recognize it. So deferring means what? You're postponing it. Clear? Is it clear, Siddhant? You're postponing. That is known as unearned revenue. You haven't recognized that revenue. You have received the money, but when you render the services, you will recognize it. So unearned revenue ka dusra naam hai deferred income. Clear? So deferral means we are receiving or paying cash first. The moment you receive the cash, it is known as deferred. If you want to make it simple, the moment you receive the cash, it is known as deferral. Clear? What is the difference between accrual and provision? So I am coming back. To the current liabilities, we have provision, right? So what is a provision? What is an accrual? So we create a provision. Accrual is nothing but, as I've said, you accrue that expenses. Provision is like you are providing for that expenses and estimate. How much should I actually provide for that expenses? Like 2%, 3%. So there is a standard protocol of the company that out of 2% of your bad debts will be your provision for bad debts, right? 2% of your services is a provision. So provision is an estimate. It's a number. It's an accounting estimate. It's a judgment that, okay, yaar, chalo, itne log every time they don't pay. So I will make a provision of 10 lakhs. So that's how provision for bad debts, provision for creditors. If it is certain, then only we have to make the provision. Yes, it should be certain and it should have an obligation. If it is uncertain and it may or may not happen, then it will become a contingency. We'll come to those chapters. Don't worry, guys. I will cover each and everything that time. Anyways, so investment. So in current liabilities, we have current portion, notes payable, accounts payable. So you have already read property, plant and equipment. Someone have asked, what is this PP&E? It is nothing but India ka fixed assets, guys. PP&E, property, plant and equipment, land, building and equipment. This is known as property, plant and equipment, nothing but fixed assets. Clear? They are all recorded at historical cost. You must always remember how your balance sheet, each and every line item is recorded and disclosed. What did I tell, guys, for investors? What is recorded and what is it shown? Current liabilities are all shown at present values, at fair value. Long-term liabilities at fair value. Equity by default is at current value. Are you getting it, guys? Yes, sir. Current assets are by default at fair value because they are current in nature. Fair value ka matlab kya hai? Jo market mein value hai, wohi wo asset ka value hai. Are you able to understand this? What is there in the market? The same value is there in your balance sheet also. Is it like cash in your balance sheet is different and market mein alag cash hai kya? Cash is cash. Are you getting it? So current assets by default are at fair value, right? Non-current assets like property, plant and equipment are shown at historical cost. Clear? Current liabilities by default are shown at fair value. Long-term liabilities are discounted and shown at fair value. Equity is shown at discount. Equity is shown at market values. It is at current values, right? And other assets or intangible assets. So debtors are there. They are also. So now there is a concept like if it is more than 1 year or 2 years, sundry debtors and all non-current assets, you should discount it and show it at present values. What do you mean by discounting, sir? Like electricity deposit, right? I have paid the deposit for next 3 years. Is it clear, guys? What we used to do in India previously, we used to show electricity deposit in assets. Guys, are you able to follow this example? I again repeat, if you see that there are deposits also in the balance sheet under asset side. Are you getting it? So when we show that deposit under asset side, right? So guys, are you following this example? So deposits, we used to show it in the asset side. So this deposit is for next 3 years, right? So this deposit, we need to discount it like using a present value factors and showing it at fair value is what US GAAP, Ind AS and IFRS is telling now. Now, no longer you can show everything at historical cost. Everything should be shown at fair value. Jo market mein value, wohi dikhao. Like $10, you are receiving it. So now suppose I have invested $10, guys, for an example. After 1 year at 10% rate of interest, how much will it become? Yes, what's the answer? $10 I have invested today. After 1 year, how much it will become? $11, right? That $11, if I want to discount it and show it at today's value, how much it will be? $10 or not? This is known as discounting. From 10 to 11, what you have done is compounding. Clear? So this is what we discount with each and every assets and show it at discounted value. We will come across it as and when each and every chapter. So every line item has an every chapter in your FAR. So today I have just given you a summary of this particular thing. Thank you so much, guys. I think we are done with it. and finished off with the first module, practice MCQs. We will come back module 2 tomorrow and start off with revenue and all. That's all we have, guys. Okay. Thank you so much. If you believe these three principles, FAR is one of the easiest subject and one of the best subject. That's why we give so many, get so many jobs in this subject. This is a field you need to master, guys. Thank you. Thanks a lot.